Next to South Africa, Nigeria is the second largest population of persons living with HIV and AIDS. It is estimated that approximately 1.8 million young people in Nigeria between the ages of 10 and 24 are affected with HIV and AIDS. These statistics clearly illustrate that young people are the most infected and affected portion of the population.
Actually, I found that when I was HIV positive, that was 1999, and then I was my 11 years, going to my 12 years. So it wasn't easy at all because it was during my illness in the hospital, and they are like, this girl, she's too young. They carried all manner of tests, all kind of things they needed to do, but they found out that the result was negative. So at the end of the day, one of the doctors now came up and said, they should do one particular test that they needed to do, which they did, HIV test, and that is where the result shows positive.
At that time, I was still very young, and I really didn't know. I didn't have much information about it, but my dad, living with my dad alone, first thing we wanted to know what was the matter, and taking into consideration that I'm also a twin. They wanted to know if my twin brother was also infected, but a test was conducted on my brother as well, and it came out negative. So we did our own mini research and discovered that it was during my blood transfusion. That was when I got infected.
I was not properly counseled or educated about the issue around HIV and AIDS as of then, because I was too young. In short, not even too young. The way the thing is rampant then is just all about death.
My family felt bad because during that time there was so much stigma, even from the media, from the community, and we just wanted to keep it at bay. We wanted to keep it. We just wanted to keep it within ourselves, and that was it. High school was one of the most challenging period of my life, with the fact that I also attended the boys only. So I mean, you know how people would get cranky, and seniors would want to send you on errands. And at the time, my friend couldn't take it. Some of my friends, I lost friends. I made new ones. For the new ones I made, they were curious to know what was HIV all about. For the ones that I lost, it was on the base of saying I don't want to get infected with HIV, and the best thing was to avoid me like a plague. So it was really, really challenging and traumatizing, and I wouldn't want to delve more on some of the things I faced. It was really, really challenging.
Stigma is not new to public health, nor is it unique to HIV and AIDS. History provides an unfortunate abundance of examples of prejudice, discounting, discrediting, and discrimination directed towards people living with HIV and AIDS. Given stigma's enduring profile across time, cultures, and circumstances, there is no gainsaying in the fact that young people are amongst the most vulnerable set affected by this stigma that comes with the virus.
Going back to school, those ARV drugs we are taking has a lot of side effects, different kind of side effects. But my side effect was the one pulling my hair. So if I go to school like that, they will ask, oh, what is happening to your hair? Adding a lot of rashes, a lot of ringworm in my hair, to the extent I'm not opening my hair again. So in that case, one of them now has to call me that, what is wrong with you, one of the teacher, which I have to like open up and say, this is what is happening. You know, at the end of the day, the way students we are coming close to me, they stop coming close to me, they are not associating with me, they are not talking to me. So in that way around, I have to stop there, going to school.
Young people are in the forefront of persons facing stigma and discrimination, not only in workplaces, but in educational institutions as well. They are constantly being deprived of their right to education, employment, health, and other social services. AIDS discriminatory practices in education institutions include mandatory testing as part of the school's admission, enrollment, and graduation requirements. These testings, more often than not, include HIV screening.
I'm aware that there's a mandatory test, but not specifically for HIV and AIDS. Like in my school, while we were enrolling as 100 level students, we were not told that we're going to take HIV test. We were told that we're going to take a general test comprised of both your blood type, your genotype, and all that, but not specifically for HIV and AIDS alone.
Yes, a mandatory test was conducted by my school for my admission.
A student that wants to go to school has the right to go to school. So an institution, any institution at all, does not have any power or right for them to check the HIV status of the student. Because, for example, if he or she is found positive, the school will definitely bring an end to the student's goal of or aim of going to school. So I think institutions have no rights or they have no business in knowing the HIV status of a student they have admitted or about to admit.
Well, to me, I don't really buy the idea of students taking HIV and AIDS test as a mandatory, has been mandatory to enroll into the university. I believe it's something that one should go on your own free will, at your own time. Take yourself to a nearby clinic or health center to check your status, not being mandatory.
People at substantial risk for HIV infection who are not tested in a timely manner because they have previously experienced or fear that they may come to experience discounting, discrediting, or judgmental attitudes from university authorities are a tangible example of stigma's impact on Nigeria's ability to deal with stigmatization and discrimination of young people living with HIV and AIDS.
I wrote my WAEC, wrote my JAMB, did everything they asked me to do. They give me the admission letter. At the end of the day, the VC come up and said, there is one test that they have not done. No, they want to do medical fitness. They didn't even tell me that, whether for HIV or they didn't even say anything. They just say medical fitness. I conduct the test. At the end of the day, the crowd was like this, where they are giving out the test. The VC now said, Gloria, we are sorry. We are withdrawing your admission because the student life is at stake. You are an HIV positive. They can't give you admission into the school. They rejected me the first university. It was at the second university, which is UNN. What I did, when they asked me to go for medical fitness, what I did, I have to call one of the doctor. I called him. I said, sir, this is who I am. I don't know my fate for now because I was going for a remedial course. Then in a suit, I was like, this is my fate for now. I don't know what to do. That what am I going to do now? The man said, okay, no problem, Gloria. For the fact you have met me, I will do something. The man have to fake a result and say this person is HIV free for them to just give me admission into the university. And that was what makes me to get angry and come out. I said, even though it's the whole Nigeria, I'm the one person among the young people that will come out and speak for the HIV thing in schools, I think the whole world will hear me. That was how I took that faith and boldness and I came up on air. I said, come, this stigmatization must stop because we have every right to live. We have every right to go to anywhere we want to go, to work in our government institution. We have every right. So why are they stigmatizing us?
During that time, there was no much information. The only information was that HIV was a death sentence.
The school makes us understand that our files are confidential and are kept by the school. So I don't think you will be stigmatized if your school knows your HIV and AIDS status.
For those encouraging the test to go on, and as long as the result is confidential, I think that's still encouraging discrimination because the school authority would definitely know, and we know how nosy people are, or how some people can keep their mouths shut.
Stigma is a complicated issue that has deep roots in the complex domains of gender, race, ethnicity, class, sexuality, and culture. Granted, it is not easily understood, nor is it readily addressed. The knowledge that a disease caused by HIV infection, whose acquisition is prominently associated with sexual and drug-using behaviors, is capable of provoking intense value-laden reactions. Unjust treatments of people living with HIV and AIDS even go as far as withdrawing admission from students who are tested positive or rusticating those already admitted in the school system.
Stigma is a label which is placed on any individual. It undermines, and one of the aspects of stigma is that it undermines productivity. Because if you have a barrier to say these are the XY people that should do this, if those XY do not qualify, there is no way you will get the best out of such process.
Mandatory testing on campus promotes stigmatization because, one, we know how nosy people can be, and the ability of someone to shut his or her mouth concerning someone's result is very, 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 very low. So definitely, if Mr. A carries out HIV test on student B, there's every possibility that Mr. A will tell someone else the result. And for someone that is positive, the news goes on about, okay, that social person is positive, hence a discrimination comes in. And for most schools, none of them, or most of them, are not honest with their blood testing policy. They will tell you that even if they make it compulsory for you to run a blood test or HIV test, it will be confidential between you and the school authority. But once a student now comes out to be positive with HIV and AIDS or HIV, then such student now gets to be the center of the school authority, because the school might now call the person, even though it's not out, they might just call the person inside the office and say, this is the result of your HIV test and you are positive. So in order to protect the lives of those that are not positive, we are withdrawing your admission and you are no longer a student. And this is wrong because such person also has same rights to education. The same right to education someone without the virus also has.
It takes away merits. It undermines. If anywhere you have stigma, you can never get the best out of any situation.
Stigmatization pushed me to the extent of stop going to school and associating with people, communicating with people, meeting people, discussing issues that affect HIV and AIDS. And I stayed away from people because I felt that I'm not in this world any longer, so why am I living?
One thing that will come into my mind if I were HIV positive and I was asked to provide my information for admission, I would take it as a process of elimination. That is one thing that will come, one of the things that will come into my mind.
It should be voluntary. It should rest on what the student wants to do. If you want to go for the HIV testing, fine. But school does, like I said earlier, don't have the right to make it mandatory or even compulsory. But a student can now willingly go for the test if he or she feels he wants to go for the HIV test. But the school does not have any right.
If you want to test, it has to be voluntary, and you need your consent. They need to seek your consent.
With so complex a phenomenon, how do we begin to confront the negative impact of HIV and AIDS stigmatization and discrimination of potential university undergraduates whose right to education is, apart from academic qualification, determined by a mandatory HIV AIDS test? The HIV and AIDS Anti-Discriminatory Bill addresses some of the key discriminatory situations faced by people living with HIV and AIDS, including access to medical services, employment, comparable wages and other working environments, hate messages, and compulsory testing as a requirement for employment.
The Anti-Stigma Bill is a bill that is still waiting to be passed by the Senate and the House of Rep to stop discrimination against people living with HIV, especially women and young people. Because Women and young people face quite a lot of challenges. They are very vulnerable. They are the most vulnerable set of people to HIV. And the bill, I think basically that is what the bill is all about. It's all about stopping discrimination based on HIV/AIDS status. There is much to gain if the bill is passed, and there is so much to lose if the bill is not passed. And what I mean by that is that people living with HIV, research has proven that people living with HIV can live a normal life. And having stigma in place will undermine access to medication, will undermine access to job, will undermine access to admissions. Because we've seen a situation where people were required to do a mandatory HIV test before they can be admitted into a school. And in that process, quite a lot of people were tested, and the best of the best brains were dropped. And that alone, it undermines getting the best.
Passing the anti-stigmatization bill will help to limit the stigmatization, because there's going to be punishment attached to stigmatization.
One of the strategic roles played by education as a vaccine in the promotion of HIV and AIDS anti-discrimination bill is the creation of the Red Card campaign. It is an initiative of the youth advocacy group of the organization. A group of 10 young Nigerians between the ages of 15 and 24, concerned with and determined to address youth health development issues through social mobilization and advocacy. It was found that the bill inadequately addressed the issues of young people, as the language only recognized stigma and discriminatory practices targeted at adults within a variety of settings, including workplace. The Young Advocacy Group developed recommendations and presented these recommendations at a public hearing. The Young Advocacy Group was the only youth group that made a formal presentation at the legislative hearing.
It was only capturing the workplace policy. It's not capturing the people in school, people in other places, especially the young ones. So it's just only capturing the workplace. That is where I felt that these young people are more in school. Even from secondary school to the university, because we have one now that is in secondary school and is in SS1. So in that case, this thing should carry that along to everybody in schools, and they should make sure that this anti-stigmatization bill should be passed into law so that it can help us to feel our freedom and work wherever we want to go.
One of such efforts is what Eva is doing currently now. Eva as an organization has been championing to say that the anti-stigma bill should be passed, because there is so much to gain. There is so much to gain as a nation, there is so much to gain as a community, there is so much to gain as an individual.
When the anti-stigmatization and discrimination bill is passed into law, it will make it punishable and offensive for anyone to discriminate or stigmatize against someone living with the virus. And when mass sensitization programs are organized by schools, by churches, by NGOs like this, and the federal government or state government are carried out to every nook and cranny of the country to tell people about the ills of stigmatizing and discriminating people living with the virus, I think there will be total elimination, or there will be minimal level of discrimination and stigmatization in Nigeria.
If the bill is passed, people living with HIV, not only people living with HIV will gain a lot. Because for every person living with HIV, it's attached to a family. And if the bill is passed, that means because of my health status, I would have access to anything. I can be enrolled in the military. I can be enrolled in any profession that I choose. I can work in the bank. If you have a law in place that says people should be subjected to mandatory HIV tests. There is no way you get the best out of that situation. And also, for people living with HIV, they stand a better chance of access to drugs, because even in the healthcare facilities, they still face some level of stigma.
Mandatory testing should be a punishable law. When the bill is actually passed into law, it should be stated that anybody who does mandatory testing in schools, they should punish them because it's not right.
We've seen prominent people living with HIV and they're still doing well. Example is Magic Johnson. He's a public figure and he's doing wonderfully well. If we have a law that has criminalized or that has stigmatized against Magic Johnson, we won't get the best out of him. I think the current dispensation, which is advocating for transformation, one of such things is the passage of this bill. If the president can make sure that this bill is passed, then we believe that transformation is at our doorstep.